The Legendarium podcast is brought to you
by you. So please visit patreon.com/legendarium
to support the show. But for now,
welcome to the Legendarium.
It felt like a fable being told.
Yeah.
So
a much longer Aesop fable.
Yes. Admittedly, this is if the tortoise and the hare had, had 80 days to get around the world type thing. So,
and then the tortoise sprouted wings and ate the hare and burned the villagers.
Yeah.
Awesome. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the Legendarium podcast. I feel like I haven't said those words in a little while, even though it hasn't been that long, but
it feels kind of weird to watch you say them.
Yeah, I am Craig, your host, and I am here with a couple of people to talk about A Wizard of Earthsea. Who is with me, you might ask? Great question! Well, we've known each other for about 24 years, and I think we have yet to decide which of us is the other's shadow demon. It's Ryan Bruckman.
You're probably the shadow. You're definitely a shadow.
Yeah, that's probably true. Never mind.
Yeah.
There are stories. Pull that mic a little closer, Ryan. All right, and over there, he's like Ogion, who finds true wisdom in silence. Yeah, no, I'm just kidding. Not he's even. The loudest person I know. It's Todd Wente.
Oh, so much fun to be back in this kind of a setting.
So, we were just reflecting a little while ago that it has been a long time since the three of us have made a podcast together, so I'm really looking forward to this. And also, by the way, I don't know if you guys saw me tweet this on Twitter this week that we got a complaint on YouTube.
Yes, it made me laugh so hard.
I'm sorry, I missed that.
Somebody told us to quit our caterwauling and get to the point. Yeah. To which I responded, you must be new here. Today we are talking about A Wizard of Earthsea. Before we get there, I will just remind everybody. Well, first of all, spoiler alert, we are going to be talking about the whole book, I guess. Spoiler alert for this 50-year-old book. Anyway, also visit us at patreon.com/legendarium if you enjoy what we do and you want to support the show. We would love that. And also find us on Discord. I don't know what the Discord link is off the top of my head because Discord has weird links, but you can find it pinned at the top of our Reddit profile. So go to thelegendarium.reddit.com and you can join our Discord from there. That's probably the easiest way to find it. And Discord is where we have the most discussion these days. It used to be Reddit where we spent most of our time, but I find Discord to be a very, very charming little place to hang out. Our Discord server is honestly, and I don't mean this facetiously in the slightest, it is a paragon of virtue amidst a sea of internet filth. It is a wonderful place. It really is.
It is. I'm very respectful, very uplifting.
Very supportive, fun.
I have been impressed when I have logged in. I don't log in often, but when I have logged in, I've been very impressed.
Yeah. And I hope that, honestly, I hope everybody who listens goes and checks it out and joins in the conversation there. And I also hope that the culture that we've built there can scale up.
Yeah.
You know, oftentimes you get more and more people and it doesn't work out so well. But honestly, I think it'll be all right.
I think so too.
Come join us. All right. So, A Wizard of Earthsea. First of all, Ryan, why did we choose A Wizard of Earthsea? I think it was just because we needed a break, right?
Well, we had talked, I vaguely remember a discussion about that we had finished Lord of the Rings. We just finished our Lord of the Rings, and that this was at one point written as in some way connection to Tolkien's writings of Lord of the Rings.
Right, right.
And we wanted to just get a view of that and see what was going on. A bit of the Tolkien connection there. And then also, quite frankly, especially on Red Team, we've tackled a lot of epic fantasy, heavier duty things that require a lot of investment of time and resources. And we needed something that was a little bit lighter, just at least in terms of page count and things like that.
Because this isn't necessarily light.
No, no.
As far as topically.
There's a lot of really nice depth to different teachings and different moments in it that I really appreciated.
Yeah. And now this is your first time having read the book.
Yes. I believe this is actually the first Le Guin story I've ever read.
It's the only one I've ever read. This is my second time through it. I read it once when I think I was about 23, maybe 24. I read this because I was a huge Tolkien fan and I was kind of digging into some other fantasy stuff. And so I picked up this one. And at the time, it just went right over my head. In a similar way, I think, to how we reacted initially to Robin Hobb. Whatever, what was it called? Assassin's Apprentice. Where, as I reflect on that one, I kind of understand a little bit better what she was trying to do and the skill involved. And at the time, I was just like, this sucks. Not quite like that, but I had a tougher time with it. Anyway, this one, on the second time through, man, did I really enjoy it. I had a great time with it.
Really?
Yeah, I did. Todd, this is your third or fourth time through?
Third time, I think.
And when was the first time you read it? Because you're old, right? So it could have been a while.
I am significantly older than the two of you in this room, yes.
Combined.
Okay, I might be almost older than both of you put together.
like you were alive when this was released and we were not, so at least run from there.
Actually, it was 1 year ahead of me, so okay, it probably hit the bookstore as I was being birthed. I read it when I was, I read it in the mid-80s.
Okay.
So when I was, in fact, I think I was 14.
Okay, middle school, high school, somewhere in there.
I got it from the Kaysville Junior High Library.
Nice.
I checked all three of them out from the Kaysville Junior High Library. I went through them in about 4 weeks, and the first time that I read them, and absolutely loved them, devoured them, loved them. They had a profound impact on me at that age. There were things that I made choices about in my life because I read those books.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, okay, Ryan, you mentioned a connection to The Lord of the Rings. I actually hunted down a little bit. I do not claim to know much about this particular subject, and I haven't read a lot of Le Guin. I've read precisely one Le Guin book, which I will remedy, actually. I am determined to remedy that. So don't worry, all you shouting hordes out there. Anyway, but I did hunt down because I was like, what was her connection to The Lord of the Rings? Did she love it? Did she hate it? Did she, you know, whatever. And it turns out she really loved The Lord of the Rings. And she told this story in, there was a kind of a collection of essays about The Lord of the Rings, and she contributed something, and she talked about how when she would pass this shelf, it was a bookstore or a library or something, and she would pass this shelf that had The Lord of the Rings on it as a new acquisition. So this is back in the, you know, late 50s, early 60s. It's early 60s, I think, because it was the Houghton Mifflin edition. And it was the one with a kind of a tan cover and the three black eyes of Sauron.
Oh.
So, you know, first edition covers. And she said, those eyes just kept boring into me. And I didn't want to read it because they scared me. And, you know, and I didn't like the title. And it seemed like it was probably really affected and all that stuff. And so anyway, but she ended up picking it up and loving it and reading it. And she read it to her children. And she said, I believe that my hesitation, my instinctive distrust of those three volumes in the university library was well-founded. To put it in the book's own terms, something of great inherent power, even if wholly good in itself, may work destruction if used in ignorance or at the wrong time. One must be ready. One must be strong enough. So that's how she felt about The Lord of the Rings. I think she probably had a somewhat complex relationship with it, as I think we could possibly pick up just by reading A Wizard of Earthsea.
Yes.
I had heard for years that A Wizard of Earthsea was a kind of commentary about or a response to The Lord of the Rings. And so I kind of had that in mind this whole time that I read it. And I don't know if we're going to get to a ton of that, because I don't know if we're quite qualified to dig into that stuff, but it is an interesting way to read the book.
The only thing I agree. I don't really know that we can give a great in-depth analysis and comparison of the two, other than just for me reading it with a similar mindset coming in, sitting here going, not so much as a commentary against or for Lord of the Rings, but just what resonated as similar and what was very different,
right,
in terms of the way that they handled things, specifically magic systems, a little bit different feel, even though I still believe that this would be qualified as a little bit more of a soft magic system.
Sure.
Similar to...
Go on.
Relatively speaking, we don't...
Not learn, compared to The Lord of the Rings, but compared to other magic systems out there.
Yes, definitely, okay, in comparison to magic systems as we know them today, it would be classified as a soft magic system. But there is still more depth to the magic system in Wizard of Earthsea than you would see in Lord of the Rings, specifically with control over using names and things like that, although there are mentions of that in Lord of the Rings. But just moments like that where I was like, this is different enough for me now that I don't feel like it would, that I never felt like it was specifically just trying to ride the Lord of the Rings wave.
Sure.
Well, and one of the things that I thought of, because we had talked about that a little bit, that perhaps that perspective needed to be there. So as I was reading the piece this time, I thought about it in those terms. What could I find? What's different? What would I identify as either lending to that or being something to say, well, maybe not. One of the things that I really appreciated differently about A Wizard of Earthsea, and I think one of the reasons that it held my attention when I was younger, was that it was not, the wizard was not a player, he was the player. And so while Gandalf ran around doing things. Yeah,
it's not about Gandalf.
None of the Lord of the Rings is about Gandalf.
Right.
But A Wizard of Earthsea, oh yes, it is all about Sparrowhawk and what he goes through. And so for me, the dramatic shift between those two, as far as the telling, let alone the style that she decides to try and use to tell this story.
Oh boy.
Dramatically different.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if I put a gauge out here and put Lord of the Rings on one side and Harry Potter on the other, where would you put the arrow?
What do you mean? Gauge for what?
Just in terms of which would this be more similar to? Because if we're following the story of a young wizard who coming into his power and doing things versus...
Still much closer to Lord of the Rings, in my opinion.
Okay.
Let's come back to that.
Okay.
What do you say we go back to the beginning? Okay, let's actually talk about the story.
Come on. Let's stop our counterrolling and go forward.
I demand to be able to do these spells immediately.
All right. Let's go back to the beginning, and I actually have a summary for you, which I will now deliver 10 minutes into the episode. All right. Dunny, a.k.a. Ged, a.k.a. Sparrowhawk, is a real dick. I mean, he's not as much of a dick as some of the people around him, to be sure. He's the kind of dick that anyone who's lived through adolescence can recognize in him or herself at some point. Problem is, Ged is a wizard, so his less than delightful tendencies have more deleterious consequences than the average kid's. When Ged tries to summon the dead to outdo a classmate at wizard school, he almost dies and unleashes his own demon shadow thing upon the world. And that sobers him up quite a bit. Almost the moment he leaves wizard school, Ged sets out on a quest to find, understand, and destroy that shadow. There are harrowing adventures, lessons learned, and friendships cemented. And in the end, I think we all learned something during this very special episode of Blossom.
Oh my word.
I'm kidding. The ending, I did find the ending extremely satisfying, but I think maybe we'll get to there in just a moment. But if we back it up a little bit, going from the beginning of the story, this kind of starts out in an interesting way where we're in the stereotypical small town with an orphan child who nobody understands. And then it really quickly takes a turn because he's not meant for the farmer's life. Right? Nobody thinks that he is, right? He's just kind of like passed around from house to house and nobody quite knows what to do with him. And then he starts exhibiting magic powers really young. And so I kind of feel like it's some of that stereotypical coming of age stuff that we read in a lot of these stories happens really quickly. Mm-hmm. And she shoots him right past that stuff. But I enjoyed that beginning part, especially because there were a few, moments. There's one in particular, which I thought this was a great moment where she upends a certain trope, and the trope is that the thing I need to know, the power I need to have, the thing I need to understand, I will acquire that just in time. Mm-hmm. Right. And so, I mean, we see this all the time now. I'm thinking of the Stormlight Archive. I will not spoil anything in the Stormlight Archive, but it's pretty well known that, especially in the first couple of books, there is a character for whom, you know, his little companion tells him, oh, you'll know when you need it. And that's exactly what happens.
That's exactly how it happens.
Right when he needs the magical power to come aid him. And, you know, that's when it happens. Anyway, so his village is being destroyed and Ged has been learning a few magic spells, but he really doesn't know all that much. He's naturally talented, but he hasn't been training for very long or with anybody very effective. There was, and this is a quote from the book, there was power in him if he knew how to use it, and he sought among all the spells he knew for some device that might give him and his companions an advantage, or at least a chance. But need alone is not enough to set power free. There must be knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, I kind of grinned a little bit when I saw that and goes, yeah, okay. So she's thumbing her nose maybe at some of the fairy tales where it just happens automatically for the hero because he's the hero.
Her approach to this was, in at least in my opinion, a really interesting blend of, I'm going to tell you the moral that you should learn. I'm going to tell you the lesson of this story.
Yeah.
But then I'm going to tell you the story anyway. And I found myself a couple of times going, oh, that was a nice little editorial comment that you threw in there that we didn't really need to know. I think we were getting that just fine.
Yeah.
But no, we're going to pull out long enough for me to say, oh, by the way, just in case you missed this, here's my information.
You know, one thing I don't know, because when we do these episodes, I think we try to approach these as ourselves. We're not here to gather up all the world's knowledge about A Wizard of Earthsea and deliver that to our audience, right? This is about our reactions to it. And so I don't know the answer to this question. Who was she writing the book for? Because if she was writing it for a younger audience, then I think those things are merited.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? If she's writing it for the 14-year-olds of the world, then, you know, maybe you do need just a little bit of help. She's going to hold your hand and say, no, this is the lesson.
And I think because of some of the other pieces that I've read by Le Guin, I think that is her target audience normally. I think based on the way that the book was written and the depth that she chose to pursue some of the issues and some of the themes, makes a very strong case for the fact that this is being written for late teens, maybe young adult, but it is not necessarily written from a standpoint of this is a book that will hold the attention of a fully adult reader who's got, you know, the weight of the world resting on their shoulders. Mm-hmm. No, this is for somebody who's trying to figure out what it is to take your place in the world. So I think she was writing these more as a teenager's book, not a child's book, but something for the teenagers, the middle readers.
Yeah. Yeah. So let's move on then in the story to the wizarding school, right? So he goes to Hogwarts and no, I'm kidding.
Oh.
Todd, easy, easy, man.
I love that every wizarding school is now
Hogwarts.
It doesn't matter what book series or anything. It's all that. Well, we do have
I'm trying to deliver this message in a way that our most Twittery listeners can understand.
Oh, well,
Harry Potter's big on Twitter for many reasons right now. A lot of discussion there. Anyway, all right. So he goes to wizarding school. Yeah, I'm not touching that with a 10-foot pole. Goes to wizarding school. And what kind of surprises me a little bit about this book is this is a slim volume. It's, mm-hmm. You know, a couple hundred pages and maybe like, what, 30, 40, maybe 50 of that is in the wizarding school.
At best.
It's kind of this formative place for him. And then he just goes on with the rest of the book. But anyway, so let's talk about that a little bit, his time there and how we see it. There is a question, by the way, I will get to the Discord comments. I don't know if I want to get to this one just yet, but people did ask us to compare it and contrast it to The Name of the Wind. Do we want to do that now or should we save that? Because he goes to wizard school and then goes and has adventures, right?
Yeah, I please don't take this as any sort of slight on Le Guin or anything else or praise of Rothfuss or anything, but I would say that this would be Name of the Wind light.
just as far as like amount of time given to that sort of thing? What do you mean by that?
Time, depth, were prose written in like the style of the prose of anything. This is very much the adventure is very similar.
Are you saying that the prose in The Name of the Wind is superior to this? And that this the prose here is Name of the Wind light?
I would say that the prose in Name of the Wind is more artistic and more aimed to be artistic than it is whereas with this one I feel it is more narrative based on narrative.
Really? Interesting.
That's
interesting. I guess it depends on how you define artistic, right?
Yeah.
And everybody's going to have their own definition of that.
I guess the bar for me here would be I can read Wizard of Earthsea to my son, and he can grasp some of the core, what's going on. He can follow the narrative type thing.
You think so? Really?
Yeah. If I read him Name of the Wind, I think he's going to struggle a little bit more just with having to listen through it.
Oh, I feel totally the opposite.
Really?
Yeah, interesting. Wow. I don't know. Todd, have you read Name of the Wind?
Not yet.
Okay. All right. Well, boy, did you just set off a bunch of listeners.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah.
That's okay. They probably all haven't read The Expanse yet.
Anyway, yeah, I kind of feel the opposite where the Name of the Wind, it's like if you have somebody like... like a Glenn Cook or somebody who uses kind of Spartan prose versus a Brandon Sanderson who describes every single button on Ellen's jacket or whatever, mm-hmm. right? I feel like Pat Rothfuss is in the middle of that where it's used well and it's artistic and all that stuff, but he still has a very descriptive style, you know, mm-hmm. that's very contemporary. Whereas this one, I feel like... this is actually another question. Kiptan asked us, how would you describe her style of imagery? Who would you most compare and contrast her to? And I was thinking about it, and I was kind of thinking about the Tolkien connection, and I thought, you know, first of all, I'm not widely enough read in fantasy, believe it or not, to say like, oh, yeah, she definitely clearly echoes of whatever author back in the 50s. I don't know. But comparing her to people that I know, if I were to take the Tolkien angle, she is somewhere in between the Lord of the Rings and the Silmarillion in her language and imagery.
I would buy that.
Okay.
At least on this read through.
Yeah. One of the, and I think you and I kind of mentioned this a little bit, that she seems to approach this from a standpoint of, I'm going to tell you a story, and then the story happens. But as the story's happening, there's moments where it's conversation and interaction, and then it's these big sections where we describe what's happening, almost as if it was in a film piece. It would be the musical montage where they're moving from one place to the next. Yeah. And there's a brevity of speech. There's very few places where it's long, extended portions of dialogue and conversation. Instead, she puts a lot of the emphasis on describing the journey. It's more about the journey
than the destination.
And oh boy, I can't believe I just walked into that one. But the other thing that's interesting about it is that for me at least, the style of prose that she uses feels much more like a fairy tale. It feels like it's designed as, we want to tell you an old story, and so we're going to use some archaic sounding terminology and phrase crafting to make it sound old, to make it sound like one of these grim fairy tales. And that's one of the things that I think for me really made it a very fun read and a very interesting read, both the first time and this time.
I think it's interesting that you say that, because one of the feelings I had when I finished this book, I looked back and I'm like, I enjoyed this, there's some really great moments here, especially here at the end. I like the messaging and everything. I felt the same way that I feel after a well-told version of an Aesop fable or something.
Yes.
I was like, that is the feeling I got off this first read-through. And where I would kind of classify it in terms of the writing on it. It felt like a fable being told.
Yeah.
You know, so.
A much longer Aesop fable.
Yes. Admittedly, this is if the tortoise dragons and the hare had, you know, had 80 days to get around the world type thing, so.
And then the tortoise sprouted wings and ate the hare and burned the villagers. And,
yeah. Yeah.
Awesome.
Then said he was sorry.
Let's, I want to get to some Discord comments. Ryan, do you have anything specific that you want to bring up before I do that, or should I go to the Discord comments and see what that brings up for us?
Most of what I want to talk about, there's a whole bunch of, we've already talked about the kind of one-line fable or one-line morals in there. There's just a bunch in there that I really appreciate, but we can dive into Discord.
Why don't you give me those. One? Give me one that you liked.
Not Oberon.
Ogion.
Ogion.
Ogion. Ogion. Ogion.
Ogion.
Ogion.
That was how it was read in the audiobook version that I read.
Oh, Ogion.
I went through it.
Okay,
time.
All right.
So, Ogion.
When he talks about To hear, you must be silent. Or
yeah, yeah.
Like that. Just little moments like that where you stop, you hear, like, especially, you know, I'm listening on the audiobook or whatever here, and it's hit the pause button and go, let me think about that for a minute here. Because on its face, like, immediately you hear that, and you're like, oh, yes, that's one of those old, you know, sayings that just rings true immediately. But then if you really take a minute to think about it, like, the depth that it takes to actually listen, it immediately sent me off off on a mental path of thinking about, okay, listening, hearing, you know, am I, you know, creating responses in my head at the same time? Am I truly to, like, silence of the mind when listening, everything, like, it immediately sent me down a path of something to think about.
Mm-hmm.
And there's, I think, 3 or 4 of them in the story that did that to me. Whereas
yeah.
I was, one of the other ones being at the very end when there was the realization of that a man, the combination of light and dark, when joined together, neither one could control the other.
Right.
Moment, things like, there's moments like that, and we can revisit those
okay.
as we want, but just a couple
real
of examples.
Quick, it sounds like you listened to this book.
Yes.
You did the audiobook?
Yes.
Okay, I wonder if that accounts for our difference in how we perceived the style and the prose.
Probably. I know people talk about this all the time, about the value of audiobooks versus reading and how they're different experience. And they really, I absolutely have come to believe that they are a very distinct and different experience.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, it can really change a book. And honestly, books that we are reading nowadays, books that are written by Sandersons or Brent Weeks or, you know, whoever, Robert Jordan, to an extent, those are books that are sometimes on purpose meant to be read on audiobook. They understand that, yeah, a lot of people are going to be doing this on Audible, and so I have to write a book that's going to be read aloud or listened to aloud, where in 1968 that wasn't probably much of a consideration.
Yeah.
And so it's just a very different moment in time.
Yeah, my first time reading it, obviously I read the second time going through in the audiobook, there are pieces of the process that changed for me. Now, granted, part of the process will also have been that they were separated by almost 40 years of history. Yeah. But as I think about what was impactful then and what was impactful this time through, things are different. Things are different. And some of that might be the medium.
Yeah, it could be. All right, so let's get to some Discord comments. Ooh, if you are new, sorry, I just knocked my phone over. If you are new to the Legendarium, then I would encourage you to go join us on Discord. And part of the reason is that we generally ask for comments and questions before we start recording an episode so we can respond to what you have to say. So I got a few of those today from our Discord server. Let's see, we talked about similarities to the Name of the Wind a little bit. Let's talk about which books or series do you think have drawn the most influence from Earthsea? Well,
ooh,
this is an interesting question from Wiley Coyote. So thank you, Wiley. I'm not widely enough read to know all of the places that this could have impacted, but I think it's a bunch. And mm-hmm. I mean, we've talked about, okay, so Harry Potter has got the Wizarding School. Mm-hmm. And if you think J.K. Rowling never read A Wizard of Earthsea, please. Of course she did. You know, I'm sure
credited
she did.
Or not.
And then we get to Patrick Rothfuss, who wrote The Name of the Wind. Mm-hmm. And he claimed, so I don't have a primary source on this, but I think it was somebody on our Discord server claimed that Pat Rothfuss says that he hadn't read this book prior to writing The Name of the Wind, which is one of those things where it's like, maybe
I need to go back and read that.
I'm not sure if I believe him, but maybe, I don't know. There are a lot of echoes between the two. So it would be remarkable if they both existed in a vacuum separated from each other. But I will say, I mentioned Brent Weeks just a moment ago. This kind of reminded me a little bit of reading the, what's the name of the series we just did, Brent Weeks?
Lightbringer,
where there's a lot of seafaring and it's kind of a Mediterranean feel to everything.
Well, and there are bits and pieces, and I don't know, as I'm thinking about where this book came in the pantheon of modern fantasy writing, It's still pretty early.
Oh yeah.
And so to look at almost any of the pieces that we see and that we kind of take for granted now, the magic system based all around names.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, okay, that's something that we see in other places as well. But my goodness, some of them really take it and run with it.
Yeah.
All the stuff that we're doing in Dresden is huge with that.
Yeah. What, did you ever read Aragon?
Yes.
Christopher Paolini?
Yes.
Wait, okay, so everything...
You mean the book that was taken from all of the other books and just kind of mashed together?
There's literally not an original thought in those books. And that's fine. Honestly, that's... If I have any complaints with that series, that's not one of them. That's fine. But yeah, that's definitely one of those echoes that you see is if you know the true name of something, then you have power over it.
Yep.
So when it comes to her being one of the first, I want to mention that for a moment. I have been thinking about this lately because it's like, okay, Tolkien, we think of him as the father of modern fantasy, right?
Sure.
He wasn't the first person to write a fantasy story.
No.
There were lots of fantasy stories before him. So what separates him? And it's sub-creation. Right, the idea of creating a secondary world that is independent from our own and has its own, you know, cultures and laws and languages and magics and all this stuff. And so I think he may not even be the first to do something like that, but he's definitely the first to do it at the level and to the degree with which he did it. And so that's where I think we draw that line between modern and pre-modern fantasy. And if we have that line, then she is definitely one of the first to kind of dabble in that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, when we look at the fantasy literature from earlier, if we want to call it fantasy literature, witches were almost always evil.
Mm-hmm.
Wizards were almost always corrupt and bent on the destruction and domination of mankind. And the hero was almost always the one wielding a sword. It reminds me of the bad adaptation First Night, where they start off the thing and it says, and after all, Lancelot was
Richard,
all handy.
Richard Gere as Lancelot.
Lancelot was always handy with a sword. I watched that. That was where I looked at my wife and I said, eject that. We are not watching this any longer. And she said, oh, it could be fun. It could be fun. I walked out of the room. The history with the exception of Lamont de Arthur, was pretty much that wizards are bad. Magicians are bad. We don't trust them. We're not going to be around them. And that shifts dramatically in tone with Tolkien. And then we get to, we start moving along and saying, okay, can we explore that a little bit further? And I think Ursula K. Le Guin does a good job of starting it. I have a couple of beefs with it that maybe we'll get to a little bit later too. But I was that was the piece for me that I think as I look at the run of this, that was really remarkable is that, yeah, we're turning a corner. This is what makes Harry Potter possible.
Mm-hmm.
Without this book, without this series, I don't think Harry Potter ever exists.
Well, sure.
There's kind of a, what you're talking about there. I really would struggle to say, I feel like this author was inspired by this book or not, you know, maybe. You know, things like the Sword of Shannara, Terry Brooks with...
It's,
you know,
pretty clear.
Like, that's kind of where I'm sitting here closest to that. But one of the elements similar to, we have good wizards now, it's the idea that magic has a price that I think is a very common trope now that we use, is realizing that you can't. You generally don't just let magic run wild.
No.
There has to be a give and a take and a cost to... to its use.
Yes.
So, and there's, I don't really know that that's not really a common piece prior to this, I would say. I don't know why I connected this series at all, but the other series, I thought it was actually around the same time. I'm curious as to if there is any effect between the two, but, you know, McCaffrey, Dragon Riders of
Pern. And McCaffrey.
Yeah.
And McCaffrey, Dragon Riders of Pern. If any of those... just kind of those early books, what tones they set from there on for what we're reading now.
That's one I'd love to talk about one of these days too.
Yeah, we really need to get into Dragonflight, etc. One day. All right, so let's go on to some other Discord questions. We already kind of addressed this one, but I do want to acknowledge No-No Rai Rai, which is, I'm sure, one of the most common phrases in your household.
Sorry, that's PTSD. Yeah,
exactly,
right there,
when you were a but a
no, Ma, I didn't. It wasn't me.
No-No Rai Rai. Okay. But No-No Rai Rai asked, how do you feel about, how do you feel Le Guin's writing compares to, for example, Tolkien, Sanderson, Rothfuss, etc. We've kind of talked about that already.
Yeah.
I would just say favorably. Really well. I love her style now. I didn't when I was 23. I do now.
It speaks really well to it that I feel that the comparison's a little bit backwards only because of where we are in time.
Sure.
Yeah.
Like, how did they compare to her?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, good. But that speaks very well to the fact that your writing has lasted as long as it has and is the bar by which you are that you would compare the best authors of our time as well.
Sure. Okay, so Lady Sweden asks, three guesses where she's from, asks, is Wizard of Earthsea the right entry point to Le Guin? If not, where to start? Well, as someone who has read precisely one Ursula K. Le Guin book, I can tell you, this is a great entry point because I want to read more.
Yeah, the two books that get the most attention for her as far as entry points, one is this and the other is Disney just did it as a movie badly.
That doesn't narrow the field very much for me, Todd.
The Left Hand of Darkness.
No. A Wrinkle in Time.
No, that's Madeline L'Engle.
Oh, that is Madeline L'Engle. I'm sorry. You're right.
Left Hand of Darkness is her other giant seller.
I liked that, but I would stay with this as a better entry point. You're right, I was confusing the two of them. Madeline L'Engle has a similar approach because it's all about the young person following the young person's journey, but it's more of a sci-fi.
Maybe. I don't know. Yeah, I think you need to read that one again. They're pretty different as far as I'm concerned.
I wouldn't always recommend this as a judgment path, but if the book title is in the general knowledge, like it's pop culture, like Wizard of Earthsea is something that has appeared in other things.
Yes.
That's probably a good sign that it's a good entry point because it's fairly well known in this case. So like I said, I wouldn't always use that as a judgment, but in this case, yes.
It's a bit like you're introduced to a new band and it's like, okay, look, they're technically their best stuff. Well, you know, it's like track 7 on their sophomore album is really just, you know, chef's kiss, right? But as far as entry points go, you want to go with the big smash hit that was the song of the summer in 2007, you know? And that's how you get into something. Okay, it's a bad comparison.
Craig is just explaining his
saying.
Path through the Evanescence soundtracks.
Oh man. Wow.
He got into it through Daredevil, but now...
You know what? Amy Lee is the greatest thing that Daredevil ever gave us. So
I'll buy that.
I'll die on that.
I'll buy that.
Okay, so let's
for a dollar.
Let's
quit caterwauling.
Yeah, that's right. We're caterwauling again. Jeff Dugan. I love when people use their actual names on Discord, or at least what I assume is his actual name, because it just makes it easier to remember. Jeff Dugan asks, maybe touchy ground and more a statement for reaction than a specific question. But Geb and the other characters are described as dark-skinned, but have been cast as white in the adaptations. Problematic? So here's the thing. Never seen any of the adaptations, so I can't speak to them.
I have.
And she's never, Le Guin has never been happy with them.
Of course not.
So.
Yeah, I'd say it's pretty rare that an author is actually happy with an adaptation of their work. But as far as it goes, you know, if that's the case, then... Problematic, I mean, compared to what? You know, at the time, you know, could they have made a better decision? Yeah. Should they have made a better decision? Yeah.
I would say anything going forward, obviously, that's...
Yeah. If they were to do that now, it would probably be more problematic than it was in the 90s or whatever. Again, not to say that they couldn't have made a better decision at that point. But it is interesting, and it's one of those things that if we talk about that just a little bit as far as the book itself, how it kind of exists in conversation with The Lord of the Rings, mm-hmm. where The Lord of the Rings is very much a Nordic-centric a kind of a Germanic, I should say, a Germanic work. And so the main characters are all white, and they do battle with the Easterlings and the Southrons and all, you know, all this stuff. And so it's told from that perspective. And this is very, very different. But the opposite of that, I mentioned it's the echoes that I see in the Brent Weeks series, because this felt very Mediterranean to me. You know, if we're speaking kind of racially, at least, if not with the seafaring stuff as well. But the most of the main characters in this are copper skinned or black. And then who do they fear? Who are the barbarians who are just you know
slavers
awful?
And the
they're the snow white folks from up north or whatever, wherever they're from. They're Vikings, basically, right? So I thought that was interesting. And it's kind of, and one of the things I like about it is that she doesn't dwell on it or anything. It's just a feature of the world. And so you can see how this would be, if you were to give it a geography in our real world, I think Mediterranean would be a really interesting one to go with, because then you do get that kind of echoes in real world history with the Vikings versus the folks down south, you know, and all that stuff. So anyway, boy, that took us far afield from the actual question, which was about adaptations. But yeah, okay, look, if they made the adaptation again now, yeah, they should probably cast that correctly.
Yeah,
that would be nice.
The one question that I think always comes up with adaptations that I always deal with is, at least as I'm looking at it, is where do you make the compromises with, if we make the compromise in the skin color and we cast the entire show with people of color or people not of color, either way, are there other ways that you can differentiate them? Absolutely. Does it diminish the storytelling that's involved? Maybe, maybe not. But if that's the compromise, if that's the compromise that's made, and otherwise it's a good adaptation, I wonder how upset we would be, or how upset she would be, if they were, because the adaptation that was done, there were some people of color that were mixed in with some of the, you know, the main characters were obviously white. They were European rather than being of a darker skin color. But a couple of the characters were people of color. But the adaptation was so bad
that it didn't matter.
That
it couldn't cover up its other sins.
In fact, when it came out, I remember saying to my wife, "Oh, I can't wait to have you watch this. This was such an influential book. I'm sure it's going to be." And it was on Sci-Fi, so I was sure it was going to be so well done. I would.
Do you know when that came out?
It was 1990. I want to say 1993.
So
1991?
Long before the Sci-Fi Channel was good.
Yeah, but I was watching a lot of stuff on Sci-Fi, so yeah.
I mean, they hadn't really hit their stride. Sharknado wasn't a thing.
no, they were producing
Sharks
lots of
Puss is actually still the best of what they've done.
Hercules, the Legendary Journeys was still kicking around. So
yeah. Kevin Sorbo.
Yeah, Kevin Sorbo before he was
disappointed.
one of my all time favorite moments.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was, and in the first 10 minutes, I looked at my wife and I said, "I'm so sorry, we're turning this off." And I.
Boy, Todd, you are just you're like just shutting shows off left and right on this episode.
This was I'm sorry, but when it's something that becomes a really important, and I'm sure you may have done some of the same thing with the Lord of the Rings adaptation, the one
The Hobbit.
The one that looked like it was a bad acid trip. Yeah, you know the one I'm talking about.
Yeah, from
now.
Back in the 70s, 80s, yeah. Whatever. 70s, I think.
If it's a good adaptation, I'll recognize where you've made compromises.
So, okay. So let me see if I can distill your position.
Sure.
From 5 minutes ago, because we went off on another tangent.
Oh, it was 3 minutes ago. Stop. Oh,
okay,
it.
Sorry. What you're saying is a racially miscast show... it's not a deadly sin for you.
No.
Okay.
Personally.
Right. No, I understand. Okay. So yeah. And I would say my thought on the matter is of all the things you could do, how do I put this? There are things that are really tough about an adaptation and there are things that are easy about an adaptation. And I'm like, well, that seems like a pretty easy win.
Amen.
Right? Get that one right.
Amen.
And then, you know, build from there. So I would rather that they do that, you know.
It's an unnecessary hurdle. It's an unnecessary hurdle to make that alteration.
Right.
So,
okay. Well, let's move on to the last one. And this is from Shifu Juju. I don't know how to pronounce that, from Discord. Shifu asks, says, I read Wizard of Earthsea last year for a book club. Wasn't my cup of tea. That's it. That's the whole comment. But I thought it was worth a response.
Dealing with that myself at home. Stephanie read this because it actually showed up in another book that she was reading or another movie or whatever. And it was guy loves girl meets girl, whatever. But the girl had to read Wizard of Earthsea so that she could understand where he was coming from. Like, that's literally the connection here. So she's like, I need to read what this book that helped, you know, understand each other or whatever. And she read it and she's like, I don't remember anything that happened. I don't know. Like,
That is the reaction I had after the first time I read it in my early 20s, where, I mean, immediately after I closed the book, I was like, wait, what? And I didn't absorb it for one reason or another. It's been too long now. I can't remember exactly why I didn't absorb anything. But if you had asked me 2 weeks ago, what is the book about? I'd be like, something about a guy, a wizard and a shadow. And that's about all I would have been able to give you. So I had read it, but I didn't retain anything of it. Now, after my second time through, I have much, much more respect for the book. I actually thoroughly enjoyed it. Really, really loved it, actually. And so I wonder if it's just exposure, where she is very different from the things that we tend to read nowadays.
Yeah.
And so it's tough for that to kind of penetrate the skull.
Well, and she doesn't deal with any real female protagonists.
True.
The one notable female in the book that shows up a couple of times is really two-dimensional and used as a trope of the deceitful and tempting young thing that gets you to do something awful and blah 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 blah. Over and over and over again. I mean, not just once, but multiple times. And so when we look at that again through the lens of time, it may not have been all that unusual in the story structure for the time. But now as we've moved forward and we do have female protagonists that are at least as strong and at least as interesting as all of the male protagonists that you might want to throw at them, especially if you've been reading some of these authors that go out of their way to make sure that they have those kinds of characters. Yeah, I can get it. I could also recognize that if you have been used to the kind of fantasy that we have been reading now on the podcast for several years, if you've been reading Brandon Sanderson and you come in to read A Wizard of Earthsea and you're like, and they have this duel that's supposed to take place and it's a paragraph.
Yeah.
When in Brandon Sanderson, that would be at least a half a chapter. And it would be the kind of half a chapter that you would turn quickly as you're moving through it. I can see that this requires a different level of expectation.
It's firing different sections of your brain, right?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Very different.
So I'm curious if somebody who did not enjoy it the first time, when I don't enjoy something, I'm not inclined generally to put myself through it again.
Sure.
I think depending on when they say it wasn't my cup of tea, I would be curious as to know what about the experience wasn't your cup of tea to decide whether or not it would be worth investing again. And if you decided to invest again, how far into the book would you go before you decided, no, this really isn't for me?
Right.
Or you realize that there is something here that I didn't catch the first time.
Maybe they just needed some Dramamine because there was too much seasickness going on. I'm kidding.
What are you talking about? I missed it somewhere.
Baseball's been gone for a while because Todd just struck out hardcore.
Oh!
what the hell were we just talking about? What were you just saying? Oh, yeah, the second time through. Oh, yeah, would you do it a second time through? Yeah, I suppose that's just a personality thing and some people have, how do I put it? I have begun separating the world into two different types of people, the type who seek pleasure and the type who avoid pain. And I think for the type who avoid pain, they would read this book, and if they didn't like it, they'd be like, why would I do that to myself again? I didn't enjoy that. Why would I do that? And for the type who seek pleasure, they would say, well, you know, I didn't enjoy that, but so many people do. I need to go back and figure out why. What did I miss?
So let me ask this of you, Craig.
Yeah.
You didn't enjoy it the first time through.
Correct.
In fact, as I recall,
not that I hated it. I just didn't. It didn't affect me.
That was one of the things that I remember early on. In some of our conversations. Oh, I can't believe you liked that. Really? I can't believe you didn't.
Yeah.
So would you have decided to do that book again had it not been for the podcast?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
I would. Because I don't think the podcast is ever going to come back to Assassin's Apprentice by Robin Hobb, but I am. I'm going to go figure out why I didn't like that book the first time through.
Okay.
Because by the time I got to the end of it, I started to see the merit in her writing style and what she was doing with the story. I started to kind of get it. And so many people love it so much that I need to figure out why I didn't like it the first time through. So yeah, I will be going back to that book.
And I think it's fair. Both types of readers, if that's the distinctions that we're going to use, both types of readers have plenty of things for them to explore and to grow from. But I'm glad that there are enough people that have enjoyed it over time that it survived.
For sure. And like I say, it's kind of that thing that made me want to go back to it is, what did I miss? So many people whose opinions I trust say that this is an amazing book and it didn't affect me at all the first time through. What's wrong with me? Let's go figure it out.
Yeah.
Anyway, and I'm glad I did.
I appreciate that point of view. We don't call that out enough. The idea of something that if you don't enjoy something, it doesn't mean that it's garbage.
Right.
And it doesn't mean that you're a bad person or anything either. But check your own lens when you look through something to realize how it affects what you're reading and doing.
And sometimes it has everything to do with, I like the phrase you use, your lens. It has everything to do with some of the context that you may be dealing with at the time. Mm-hmm. I think part of the reason that I loved A Wizard of Earthsea was because I was Ged's age.
Mm.
And it was this idea that even at that age, wonderful things can happen. And so I bought into it.
Yeah. So we haven't talked much about the story itself. I got us up to, now that we have 5 minutes left, I got us up to wizard school and then just kind of abandoned that. But now that we've gotten through the Discord stuff, maybe we come back to that a little bit and just say, okay, so what else happens? He goes, after he graduates, he goes and takes on the dragon for the island people. But he says, you know, I got to leave because this shadow thing is chasing me. So he runs away from the shadow and it chases him down at this castle where the temptress lady kind of seduces him into almost giving his soul to a rock. And there's a confrontation with the shadow thing there. And then he turns into a hawk and he flies back to his hometown. And it's at that point that he decides, no, I need to stop being hunted by the shadow. I need to go on the hunt. And so he turns around and faces it, and that's kind of takes us through the last leg of the story when he meets up with his old friend Vetch from wizard school, and they go hunting the shadow together. Okay, so now that gets us to the end of the story. Let's talk about the ending a little bit. And as you said, Ryan, this is very Aesopian in its, I would say, Blossom-esque. And it's, the moral of the story.
Yeah, very interesting that you're connecting it to Blossom.
Okay, we could do South Park. You know, I think we've all learned an interesting, a valuable lesson here.
I was thinking the Animaniacs with the Wheel of Morality telling us.
turn.
Yeah, tell us the lesson that we should learn.
Yeah.
Ching!
There you go. Anyway, it's a decent lesson, and I think it's interesting, again, in conversation with the Lord of the Rings, right? If we kind of put them together, the Lord of the Rings is a very, it does include internal struggle, obviously, with Frodo and Gollum and wrestling with the ring and all that stuff. It does include that, but the story is made epic. It's epic fantasy because of all of the external grand good versus evil battles and, you know, all that stuff, like the world events that are happening. There is none of that.
Nope.
It's all about an internal struggle, and it's not even, it turns out in the ending we understand, and I mean you know, as adults, you can kind of see it coming from a mile away. But you come to understand in the ending that the shadow was part of Ged all along, and he was chasing down a part of himself, and he had to reunite with it to become a whole person again, right? And so it's not an external force like the ring. It's himself, right? And so he has to, it's his shadow link, right? If we're going video gaming here. So.
Yes, I think that this could be very easily compared to the great classic literature piece, Fight Club.
Sure. Which one's Durden, the shadow?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, actually, my legitimate actual classic literature connection would be the Jekyll and Hyde story.
Oh, thank
separating
you.
Man, good, man's good and man's evil, what that does to a person, and then trying to reintegrate the two.
Yeah.
And that's, I think that's one place where those two stories differ. They take a different path at the end when, obviously, Jekyll and Hyde, they don't recombine, but when they're forced into a confrontation, it falls apart, everyone dies.
Right. It's a tragedy.
Yeah. Whereas in this case, it becomes the moral that good, your good side and your evil side, your light and your dark, so long as they, I think it's funny how they combine it. It was saying they both said the name at the same time.
Yeah.
And everything. When they are combined and neither has control, entire control over the other, that's when you become a whole person again.
Yeah.
You're not shunning one side or the other. You realize that there is that both parts to you and don't give entire control to one or the other. I was like, that's quite a message.
A man who embraces both, and I'm paraphrasing, but it seems like they said something along the lines of, a man who embraces both parts of himself cannot be controlled by either, cannot be controlled yes. by an external force.
Right, right.
I was, and you know, pretty heavy handed as sure. far as.
And that's why I say, you know, this is probably meant for younger yeah. audiences. And so I have no problem with heavy handedness to a certain degree in that case.
Yeah.
Right. But it does make me wonder, well, first of all, I should say, I've been talking for a long time about how I wish that more, especially big projects like something like Star Wars. You know, I've always wanted with the new trilogy, I wanted Rey to combine, she and Kylo Ren to combine light and dark together, and you know, make the Force whole again. Right, that would have been a cool storyline for me. And I was like, why can't we have stories like that? Well, here it is. Yeah, you know, this is that kind of story, right? And anyway, so I also wonder what my reaction to this would have been had I read it at a younger age, at a 14 yeah. like you did, Todd, because this is very much a coming-of-age story.
Yep.
And as an adult, I can look at this and see, you know, and I'm sure it'll be different when I'm 40, 50, 60. It'll, you know, it'll keep changing and my perspective will be different. But even now, I can see, you know, what... shadows or shades of myself as a kid when I yeah. was a cocky braggart who wanted to impress everybody, and so in my pride did horribly foolish things, right? Like, I can see that in myself, and I can see where I grew to accept certain parts of myself that I always kind of wanted to reject, and that helped me to become more comfortable and all that stuff. So I can see that now. I wonder yeah. what my reaction would have been at a younger age when I didn't have that perspective.
I know I know as I went back through and reread it this time, the one thing that I found myself going, oh, I love this story. And now I look back on one piece, one aspect, and I say, uh-uh, I don't buy it. And that is that an 18 to 19 year old young man has the depth of wisdom that Ged develops along this way in such a short period of
well,
time.
Well, okay, look, I get it, but here's my counterpoint. You and I didn't have that wisdom when we were 18 years old because we didn't unearth a demon and loose it upon the world and almost die in the process. I'm just saying,
well,
like,
maybe you didn't.
There's a few people in England that might disagree with me on that one.
But do you know my point? Like,
I do. I do.
There's, it's a bit like,
and we didn't go to wizarding school.
True.
So
no, but it's a common complaint with the Wheel of Time that everybody's so young, they wouldn't be able to do all these things. Well, you know, they've been through a lot.
When you live in a time when your lifespan is maybe 40 years,
yeah, exactly.
You're already in middle age at 19. He's there. You're fine.
Yeah. Anyway, so yeah, that doesn't really bother me. I was thinking about that because it really is, as I was reading, there was a switch that was flipped.
yeah.
with the event when he releases the shadow and it almost kills him and then runs away or is expelled, I suppose, by the Professor Dumbledore or whatever. sorry, Todd. when that event occurs, like the Ged before and the Ged after,
dramatically
almost no
different.
Relationship to yep. each other except for memory, right?
Yeah.
It really does change him because it's such a traumatic event. So I do buy it. Okay. I'm okay with it.
All right.
Yeah. Well, I agree to disagree, I guess, Todd.
Right. No, I get it. And as a 14-year-old, it impacted me so heavily that I got it and I kept it. The other thing that I think will be interesting and that I think maybe I need to do is go back and read the other two books.
Oh, yeah.
Because there's much more about Ged and about his and about the things that he does in his life. And because I there's a couple of moments that I remember. I just don't remember how old he is when he does them. And so I think I'm going to have to go back and reread those and find out if my desire to have him age well pays off.
Well, hang on, Todd. If you're silent, you can hear the sound of typing on Discord of people saying you guys should really read books 2 and 3.
I know.
So,
sorry.
Eventually we will. I'm sure, this will be a fun one to come back to and read book 2. I don't know. Ryan, would you do it? Did you enjoy this one enough to read book 2?
I did.
For the show?
Yeah, I wouldn't have a problem going and reading the other two.
Good to know. All right, well, any other final thoughts? Any lightning round observations? Anything you want to share before we call this one good?
I'll tackle, we've already touched on the subject, but specifically the way this was written and the quote, I really loved this moment. And it's in the moment where the stone was almost going to take him over, but he's able to get past whatever.
Right.
immediately hit the bookmark button in the car while listening. Said, he had almost yielded, but not quite. He had not consented. It is very hard for evil to take hold of the unconsenting soul. And I was like, oh, that's one of those. I said there's like 3 or 4 in the story that grabbed me. That was one of them that I'm like, I need to mark that so I can come back to it when we talk about it. Because that is a huge lesson for people to learn, especially right now in frustrating times and dealing with this, is as much as you can, as hard as it may be, don't relent. Because it is very difficult for evil to take over an unconsenting soul.
Interesting. All right.
For me, the one piece that I really loved and continue to love is the relationship between Ged and Ojayan. That when Ged almost loses himself, he goes to his master.
Yeah.
To his first mentor. And I have had lots of teachers in my years, but I continue to call Steve on a regular basis and say, we need lunch because I have something that I think only you can help me worm out. And he's been very much an Ojayan to me.
Nice. Oh, that's very good. I have a final thought that is nowhere near the level of what you guys are talking about.
Oh boy, here we go.
No, this is one of those, as I was reading, so I read the book, you guys listened to the book, and so you didn't experience this, but it's one of those little things that I would like to see more often, and that is, so epic fantasy, or in this case, high fantasy, we didn't really talk about the difference in this episode, but it is worth, maybe a weekender or something, but in fantasy, modern fantasy, maps are a big thing, right? Every story has to have a map so you can know where you are, because these stories span continents and oceans and all this stuff. And this story is no different. There's a map, but the map is interspersed throughout the text. So as you read, as you move to different islands, every once in a while, you'll turn the page and you'll see a map on the other side of the page. And so you can see, oh, okay, in this part of the story, he sailed past this island and he's going here, and you can actually see it. And it's just a little bit different that it is integrated with the text as you go through the story. And I thought that was a really nice touch. And I would like to see that. Actually, I would wish the Lord of the Rings would have done that.
Oh, yeah.
If I'm being honest, it would have been really nice to have because the map moves with the story. You zoom in on different parts, right? So that would have been good. I really like that about this. All right. Anything else, gentlemen?
No, I'm good.
Okay. All right, everybody. Thank you so much for listening. I hope it was interesting and enjoyable. And after this, like I said, we'll probably come back to Earthsea at some point, because I have my eye on the giant one-volume Earthsea compendium. I want an excuse to buy that. So we'll come back to this at some point, but it may be a little while. Next up, we are going into Broken Earth by N.K. Jemisin. At least the red team is. Blue team, you're going on with Dresden Files.
Yep.
You're done with The Expanse for now.
Temporarily.
Temporarily.
Yeah, we're putting a pause on The Expanse.
Right. Anyway, so that's what we have coming up. I don't know that we're going to do the entire Broken Earth trilogy. I imagine that we will, but I'm going to reserve the right to just do one book, I suppose. We'll see how it goes. I don't know. Ryan's looking at me very surprised. Like, are we doing all three? Are we committing to all three?
We don't have to commit to all three. I mean, we went through Assassin's Apprentice despite having
all three of those books.
Limited appreciation for it.
True. Yeah, and yeah. All right.
I wouldn't commit us to it, but I think it'll probably happen.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's what we have coming up next on the podcast. Thank you all so much for listening here. Again, if you enjoy what we do, then go to patreon.com/legendarium and support the program there. You can also go to join the conversation on Discord and also hit us up on Twitter @LegendariumPod on Twitter. And I would love to see you guys there. You can heap all sorts of abuse on us for the things that we forgot to talk about. And the conversation will continue in those places. So thanks for listening again, everybody, and we'll see you next time.